money. What kind of terrorists are you?
Who said we were terrorists?
Intelligent, dresses well, and distinctly Eastern European.
You gotta be on fucking TV with that accent.
This is Hans Gruber from the film Die Hard. He's the terrorist of the 1980s. His opponent, the cowboy American.
Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker.
Above all else, when Hans murders and plots his terrorist actions, there's a devilish delight to it.
You're very perceptive.
He's fun to watch at its most villainous. Let's jump ahead and land 20 years in the future. Post 9/11. This is Abu Bakar from the film Iron Man, and his cowboy American is unleashing a lot more hell than John McClane. Bakar is no Hans Gruber, you probably don't even know the name. He's not a fun terrorist.
He's all yours.
Those are far more rare after 9/11. Fighting terrorism is brutal now. Franchises went from silly to serious and campy fun to gritty. They had to adapt to a world where terrorists had delivered a decisive blow, where the hero didn't stop them in time. So what defined the new movie terrorist? We're gonna look at three things. 1. Terrorism was no longer fun. 2. All Arabs are terrorists.
Holy shit, it's a terrorist!
And 3. Patriotism is our greatest weapon.
Hello, patriots!
Alright, so let's clarify what makes a movie terrorist as opposed to your average criminal. There's a lot of definitions for terrorism, and I'm gonna use its simplest. Terrorism. Systematic use of terror for coercion.
Sir, it's not our war. It is now.
Lessie is displayed through the same character in different films with the Joker.
Aye.
Versus a terrorist.
Batman must take off his mask and turn himself in. Every day he doesn't, people will die.
And now it's just a criminal.
Do I look like the kind of clown that could start a movement? I killed those guys because they were awful.
One uses terror for coercion, the other only creates terror through killing. By definition, all violent criminal acts are going to create terror, but that doesn't mean every bad guy is a terrorist. Over the years, the face of terrorism was clear. In the 40s, it was the Nazi spies, and after that, Soviets held a near monopoly in the market with a fair mix of whoever else was in the news that year. After the Soviet Union fell, Hollywood's lead villains were left nationless. Just as James Bond had to reinvent himself following 9/11, the same is true a decade prior.
I think you're a sexist, misogynist dinosaur. A relic of the Cold War.
Half of the terrorism films made in the 90s featured former Soviets or Eastern Europeans, many in the direct mold of Hans Gruber. The others displayed a wider array of terrorist groups. The IRA, Christian fundamentalists, and of course, radical Islamists.
Our destiny is to deliver the vengeance of Allah into the belly of the infidel.
The film Executive Decision revolves around Middle Eastern hijackers taking over a 747 and heading for Washington, D.C. Sound familiar? Well, the leader intends to blow up the plane, but none of his men know.
This has nothing to do with Islam.
He actually kills one when he's questioned if this is a suicide mission. The other major Middle Eastern terrorism film, True Lies, is a 90s time capsule, made for one-liners and not world politics. This is fun terrorism.
You're fired.
When director James Cameron was asked why he never made True Lies 2, he said, terrorism isn't fun anymore. Now let's see movie terrorism after the attacks. We'd get public mass murder, filmed executions, and torture of children. You can see the contrast. Most Islamic terrorism films since the attacks have been based on true events. You can actually see a dead period for terrorism films in general, starting in 2002. Anything released that year was in production before 9/11. 2003 features almost nothing that can fit the genre. The opportunity for fun terrorism came in the form of parody, most notably Team America, in which Hollywood itself is the villain. I'm not saying terrorism films can't still be popcorn escapism, just that most of your baddies aren't the same fashionable devils that ruled the screens in the 80s or the bumbling goons of the 90s. Even when your terrorist is a charming devil, what had to change to get him there?
You should have let me sleep.
Khan Noonien Singh is the most important villain in the Star Trek franchise, and one of the most iconic in film history.
He is brilliant, ruthless, and he will not hesitate to kill every single one of you.
And in the post 9/11 reboot film Star Trek in the Darkness, he's a terrorist. In the original series, Khan was an Indian Superman, played by Mexican actor Ricardo Montalban.
You have a tendency to express ideas in military terms.
He was a charming, sexual, and brilliant military man, seen as an equal to Napoleon and Alexander. Khan was a general commanding his army in war.
You are a murderer!
In the reboot, Khan is no longer a general leading troops, but instead a man in the shadows organizing terrorist attacks. Among the biggest changes to Khan is the casting of Benedict Cumberbatch. To give credit where credit is due, he does play a fun terrorist and is enjoyable to watch, but why was an Indian character played by a Mexican actor changed to be British? That leads to my next point. In Hollywood's view, he couldn't be a fun terrorist like Hans Gruber without the change.
You apparently would do a very good Alan Rickman.
What would you like me to say to you?
Casting any brown actor in a terrorist role is going to be seen as a commentary. It doesn't sell as well as sexy and intelligent Sherlock Holmes. Khan is of Sikh origin, but to the general audience, that wouldn't make a difference.
Oh shit, what? Fucking Arab!
I'm a Sikh!
Sikhs are commonly mistaken for Muslim.
It's not that gonna be awesome.
If you look the part, you are the part.
99, you know what? That is profiling.
Oh. Wow. That's a bad guy.
Did you see his face?
In comedy, all Arabs and those who look like them are terrorists.
You ain't going nowhere without us, Osama.
If you got to go to the bathroom, we going with you. She holding and I'm shaking, player.
The post 9/11 years actually saw a decline in Middle Eastern terrorists on screen and fictional movies. Our most common enemy? North Korea.
Hello.
This is because conflict with North Korea remains fun escapism for the audience. They have never launched a terrorist attack on our country, and we're therefore more comfortable portraying them doing so. It's the impossible possible, much like this once was.
You from the north?
Olympus's fallen director, Anton Fuqua, said he chose North Korean terrorists because he felt Middle Eastern terrorists had been covered to the point of saturation. Sister film White House Down featured white nationalist terrorists for a similar reason.
Apparently we're all Arabs.
Arabs on screen were more common in comedy than they were in action.
A 9/11.
Oh, 9/11, it's the best.
We don't go to the movies to be reminded of the news haunting our living rooms, so the Hollywood terrorists of the O's became robots and aliens.
I think you are another of these desert-loving English.
With the rise of all Arabs are terrorist humor, came the death of the noble Arab role. Going back to the Silent Age, this was commonly a Middle Eastern prince, faithful and proud. White actors in Arab roles stopped for the most part after 9/11, not just because of racism concerns, but because they didn't want to be associated with those roles.
Oh, so we are the bad ones.
I'm just saying, it's not so cut and dry.
In the inverse, Middle Eastern actors were typecast and restricted from wider roles. When white actors did begin to play Middle Eastern roles again, it was as the noble prince.
Appreciate luck.
You, red bag, the red bag, stop right there!
Following the attacks, Universal ordered the Bourne identity go into reshoots that would make the story less anti-American, which, if you know the government's surveillance premise of that franchise, it's a hard sell. Those pro-American reshoots didn't stick, but this demand did set the stage for what studios expected from action films in a post-9/11 world. The focus was now on patriotism. Die Hard 4, originally titled Die Hard 4.0 in relation to its hacker plotline, was retitled Live Free or Die Hard. In contrast to the original's Christmas setting, this film takes place on the 4th of July and introduces a villain obsessed with American culture.
I am doing the country a favor.
Who tried to warn the intelligence agencies of 9/11 is now taking his revenge for their failure. Any terrorist attack was an attack on America and her values. Some characters ended up being blinded by their patriotism, to the point it became comical.
I pledge allegiance to the flag.
Let's contrast London Has Fallen, which is about Middle Eastern terrorists, with one of the most famous action films in the 1980s.
Wolverines!
Red Dawn gets unfairly labeled as American propaganda when it's actually a critique on our involvement in Vietnam. It represents the exact tooth-and-nail last-man-standing tactics the Viet Cong used to outlast their enemy, but this time through the perspective of unforgiving American teenagers. Here's a scene where Patrick Swayze confronts the antagonist's Soviet general before blasting him away. Let's wait before we hear Swayze's one-liner and contrast this with a one-liner scene from London Has Fallen.
So why don't you boys pack up your shit and head back to Fuckheadistan or wherever it is you're from?
Now hearing that line, what do you think Swayze's response is going to be to this inhuman scum? Welcome to America, better dead than red. Eat this, you commie bastard.
You lose.
It's not patriotic or even anti-communist, it's a fact. Things have gotten to the point that even anti-war films are seen as American propaganda. American Sniper tells the story of Chris Kyle, a deadly Navy SEAL serving his country after the attacks. Kyle suffers from PTSD, is uncomfortable with hero worship, and becomes disillusioned in the face of unpatriotic behavior.
Fuck this place.
Huh? What'd you say?
Fuck this place.
The message was mixed up by a lot of the audience. Patriotism has been so weaponized by films since 9/11, even the anti-war films seem to wave the flag high just because the flag is there. America needs a bad guy. At the end of the 20th century, Middle Eastern terrorists were on the rise in film. Following 9/11, terrorism remained the enemy of our fictional movie heroes, but it wasn't the same terrorists we saw on our television screens. Hollywood blasting away Nazis or lighting a flame the Manson family is therapy for past trauma. America wasn't ready to see Bin Laden killed on screen until the real thing happened. And then the healing began.
That girl was a freak. She said she wanted me to fuck her harder than the military. Fuck Bin Laden. Fuck Bin Laden.
Things are changing. Egyptian actor Rami Malek only accepted his villain role in the James Bond film No Time to Die on the condition he would have no religious motivations as a character. So how did 9/11 change terrorism on film? In the same way it changed all of us. It gave us trauma. After any major terrorist attack, you're gonna see its fingerprints in how we tell stories. Terrorism on film wasn't as easy as watching your villain fall to his death from a burning building anymore. The new movie Terrorists came from our fears, and just as with any trauma, we're dealing with it.
Some men just want to watch the world burn.
There'll always be men who want to watch the world burn, just as there'll always be the cowboy hero. Movies are simpler like that. That's why we like them. And that's why we need them. Where were you in 9/11? American September is a documentary film project collecting stories from all 50 states and around the world. If you'd like to share your story, visit AmericanSeptember.com, where you can view all the memories collected so far. The link to the website is in the description. Quick shout out to Dylan, who gave me the idea for this video. If any of y'all have ideas for future videos, feel free to reach out to me. I'd love to hear them.